Hello everyone, welcome to VTV Sikshana program for the subject on climatology for architecture students with subject code 18ARC33. We are in module 2. We had been discussing about thermophysical properties of materials. In the last lecture we have covered the basics of heat and heat flow and the characteristics of heat flow and different terminologies related to heat flow, especially conductivity, resistivity, conductance and resistance. So let us see some other specific terminologies that are related to the building components and the building elements in this particular lecture. So we are in module 2, this we have covered 3A and this is 3B, and we will be left out with another one more lecture in this module 2 after this one. So we in this particular lecture we are going to discuss about solar air temperature. There is error here. I think we are changed to solar temperature. So this is solar temperature. Then we are going to discuss about air transmittance. So how air offers certain resistance and how air behaves with respect to heat flow, especially on the upper layers, on the outer layers of the walls and other materials of the buildings. Then based on which we'll be discussing about U value, which is nothing but thermal transmittance, which is very important to understand or know with respect to building material. The major characteristics of one of the major characteristics of buildings that is very well used in thermal behavior of the building and building envelope. Then we have heat transfer through glass and glazing, where we discuss about these three factors. Especially focusing on shading coefficient and solar heat gain coefficient. So let us see from the last lecture how we had been heading ahead. So we have discussed about multi-layer bodies where only thermal resistances are additive. So we have seen this in our last discussion. So as we have seen in last lecture also, so resistances are additive, directly additive, so where total resistance is R1 plus R2 plus R3 and so on. So if you have different layers and with different resistances, overall resistances of these different layers, so we will just add them to get the overall resistance, and then the conductance will be 1 by R. So that is what we have discussed in our last lecture. So let us see what happens here is in this lecture what we are going to focus upon especially is that for example, if this is a wall with this as outdoor and this is indoor. So when outdoor, we know that there is solar radiation that hits the wall and then the heat transfers from outdoor to indoors if indoors are lesser temperature compared to outdoors. So what happens here is the air that is here, the air a layer, it's a virtual layer that we are assuming that there is a certain layer which is getting affected by the radiant heat gain that is happening on the surface of this wall. So on the surface of the wall, when the radiant heat is falling, this adds up heat to the surrounding air, and that air film acts as a layer which is offering certain resistance to the heat flow, and we are going to consider that, and we'll see what are the different aspects that we'll be looking into that. So the first one is solar air temperature, the solar temperature we call as. The solar temperature is nothing but, it is not just the ambient air temperature. If you take a temperature reading of the air on the outside of the wall, you get certain reading, but the temperature of the air when we take it adjacent to that outdoor wall, so that will have an impact of the air temperature or at plus the impact of the radiation that adds up to the temperature of this air. So that the solar temperature is an imaginary temperature of a layer of an air adjacent to the sum of the ambient air temperature. So it is equivalent to the sum of the ambient air temperature plus the calculated temperature effect of solar radiation. So ambient air temperature, we have certain ambient air temperature which is of this air which is on the outside, plus the solar radiation which is adding up extra heat to this surface and the surrounding air. So we add that to the ambient air temperature to get this solar temperature. So solar temperature is equal to ambient air temperature, the outdoor air temperature, plus the temperature that is created due to the incident solar radiation. How is that calculated? Which is radiation intensity. So you have this radiation intensity, which is I, multiplied by with the absorbance of the surface. So the surface will absorb a certain heat inside. So if the absorbance is happening if the absorbance is more, the material absorbs more and more heat, the material's temperature will be higher. As we have discussed in specific heat and the thermal capacity, that more heat is added, the temperature of the material increases to certain degrees. So this absorbance, if the absorbance is more and more, the temperature will be higher and higher. That's why it's on the numerator. Then we have outside surface conductance. So outside surface, the surface of the layer, the outer layer of the wall or any other material which is exposed to the outside air, the surface conductance of that particular material is also factored. If the conductance is more, then the air conductance, the heat that is given to the air film will be lesser. So that's why it is on the denominator. So here it is radiation multiplied by absorbance of the surface divided by outside air surface conductance. So that gives our the temperature impact due to the radiation. So outdoor temperature plus temperature of the surrounding air due to radiation is added together to get soil air temperature. So that is soil air temperature. So apart from the resistance offered by the body to heat flow, the surfaces of the body also offer resistance. So what happens here is the body is allowing certain heat or resisting certain heat, but along with that, the surface of this material also acts as an extra material which offers an extra resistance, where a thin layer of air film separates the body from the surrounding air. So in this soil air temperature we have seen, we assume a thin layer of air here which acts as another material which offers certain resistance to the heat flow. So the units are same as thermal conductance and resistance. So the surface conductance which is this air surface air layer conductance. So this air layer, the conductance and the resistance of this air layer is what we are talking about, surface conductance and surface resistance. Like any other material, this is one more material which is specific to the air that we are discussing about here. Surface conductance and resistance, the transfer of heat from air to a surface of the body and from surface to the air is called surface conductance, also called film conductance or film coefficient. So surface resistance is the resistance offered by the surface of the body as different from resistance offered by the body itself. We have a body and its surface as a separate entity which has a thin layer film which offers certain resistance and thus there is a difference in the conductance offered by that particular surface layer. So surface conductance applications, like how does it help, where do we see and how do we observe it? So lower surface conductance will reduce the heat losses in cold climates. So in cold climates, because the inner temperatures are higher and outdoor temperatures are very lower, we should not lose out heat. So when we don't want to lose out heat, the surface conductance should be as less as possible, so that your heat loss is not happening. Similarly, in hot places, the surface conductance should be as high as possible, so that reduces solar overheating. Higher value of surface conductance, your inner surface conductance, if it is higher, the conductance, sorry, I'm sorry, the conductance. So just to revise it again, in warm climate, so when you have warm climate, when the solar radiation is hitting the wall, so this is our wall and this is our external surface. So higher the value of surface conductance, if the surface layer, this layer is conducting more and more heat, it can dissipate the heat to the surrounding air very quickly and thus reduces the solar overheating. Also, if the surface conductance is higher, if the surface is conducting more, there is certain amount of heat that is added to the inner areas also. But because of the higher surface conductance, which is of air film, more heat is given to the surrounding air, and thus it dissipates more and more heat. If it is not a very good conductor of heat of the this particular surface conductance, if it is not that good of surface conductance, then what happens is the heat that is gained by the wall surface is not dissipated to the outdoor air, and thus the heat goes inside the building and heats up the building. In warm humid climates, a higher value helps us in dissipating the heat to the outdoor air. So thus the greater surface conductance value, the more heat will be dissipated to the outdoor air. Then cavity resistance. We all know about air offers. So there is, if we construct a wall with certain air gap and construct another wall as an outer wall, if this is indoors and if this is outdoors, then this air gap here, so this air gap also offers certain resistance to the heat gain. So this resistance offered by this cavities is what we call as cavity resistance. So if an airspace or cavity is enclosed within a body through which the heat transfer is considered, this will offer another barrier to the passage of heat. So the resistance offered to heat flow by cavity enclosed within the body is what is cavity resistance. Similarly, as we have for building materials or any other material that you value the conductance and resistance, this air cavity, make sure that this air is, the cavity is sealed. Because if it is open, if there is, for example, if I have a wall, if I have another wall, and if the air inside is not sealed, if you have an opening on the outer wall, for example, the air keeps exchanging with the outdoor air, and thus convection comes into play, than air acting as a resistor, air acting as a resistance offering agent to the conductance that is happening. So we should not get this convection happening in between. It should be sealed air, cavity should be completely packed so that the air moves within there as a one entity which is closed, and thus it is not interacting with the outdoor air or indoor air. So in between two walls, this air acts as another wall which offers certain different resistance or different conductance values. So thermal conductance, we have discussed in the last lecture itself, the conductivity per unit area of specified thickness. So here we are taking different thickness, like we have discussed, the conductance for 9 inch brick wall is different, conductance for 4 inch brick wall is different, but conductivity of both the walls might be same. So thermal resistance is 1 by conductance is what we have discussed. So higher the R value, better the insulating performance. Then we have solar gain. Before discussing solar gain, let us just quickly see about the thermal transmittance. So coming to thermal transmittance, we know that there is certain wall and it offers certain conduction. So there is a wall of certain thickness which offers certain resistance and it conducts heat. But we also have studied that the wall has an outer layer which has surface conductance, that outer film and inner film. So both these layers, this inner surface and outer surface, acts as an element which offers certain resistance, which conducts certain heat. So what happens here is the rate at which the heat transmitted from air on one side of the wall or roof to air on the other side is what we refer to as thermal transmittance, which is also called a U value. The U value is nothing but a conductance of a wall. This is your wall and its conductance is C. Now I have the air resistance here and air resistance here. So if the resistance of this wall is R, if the resistance of outer this is out and this is in, let's say. So outer air resistance is RO and inner air resistance is RI, the overall R including the air to air resistance will be R equal to 1 by RI plus 1 by R plus, let us say this has R initial or RA. So this is 1 by RA plus 1 by R outer. So once we know this resistance including the surface resistance or surface conductance, then it's easy to calculate the U value, where U value will be 1 by R, where this R is including the outer and inner air resistance. So that will become our U value. So when we talk about the material conductance, then we say C value, which is C equal to 1 by R. Here U is equal to 1 by R, which includes in the surface resistance. So inner and outer surface resistances also. So once we include that and calculate the resistance and calculate the conductance, so that conductance is what we call as U value. So if you want to see, revise it simply, you have conductivity, the property of the material. You are adding to the property of the material, you are adding to the surface layers and calculating the overall conductance, and that gives us the thermal transmittance. So thermal transmittance and conductance are one and same, only that in conductance we are talking only about the material, but in the transmittance we are talking about the material along with the surface conductances and resistances on either side. It is most commonly known as U value, and the units are same as it is for conductance. So conductance units and transmittance units are same, because transmittance is conductance including the surface conductance also. So if the U value is lower, we know that conductance is lower. So when conductance is lower, the heat flow is lower, which means less conduction, that means better insulation. So for insulating materials, the K value, which is conductivity value, if you remember, for insulation materials, conductivity is very, very less. That means heat flow is also very, very less, which means insulation is very high. Similarly, since the conductance is proportionate to conductivity, if the conductivity is more, the conductance is also more, we know that. So U values are also in the similar way, if lower U values we offer good resistance. So when we are trying to make a house, if you are having very hot temperatures outside, if you want to keep indoors very cool, very in a comfortable zone, your wall should act as a strong resistor to the heat flow. So when we want walls to act as strong resistor to the heat flow, it should have lesser U value, and that is one property that we will consider while doing our designs. When we are trying to add 2-3 different layers of walls and trying to finalize one wall, let's say 9-inch brick wall I'm having, and then I'm having a stone cladding on the outside, and inside I'm having some precast boards or something. So we have three different materials of different thicknesses. So I calculate the overall U value including the surface film resistance, and I'll calculate the overall U value, and that gives me the understanding of how that wall would perform compared to a bare 9-inch brick wall. So this is how U value is used for a specific assembly. In other words, the U value is conductance of various materials kept together. So the U factor is overall coefficient of heat transfer. So generally this is not just conductance, it is what is generally referred as overall heat coefficient of heat transfer. So once we know U value of a given wall, which is 1 square meter area, so for one, we know that conductance is for 1 square meter area. So let us say of T thickness, so there is thickness of T and this is 1 square meter area. The amount of heat that flows from outside to inside for 1 degree change in temperature. So 1 degree change in temperature, the amount of heat that is flowing from one side to outside, considering the surface resistance, is what we call as U value. Because once we know this, we can calculate the amount of heat that is flowing for given temperature difference for different size of walls. So we can do any n number of calculations to understand how much of overall heat that is coming inside the building through conduction through a given wall of certain area of certain change in temperature. So we will do certain calculations possibly in next lecture once we understand all these concepts very well, how to use it to calculate the overall heat transfer and all sensible modes of heat transfer. So which is convection and radiation. The U value is also factoring understanding the air exchange, the heat exchange among the air, that air film offering a certain conductance and giving heat to the surrounding air. The radiation that is falling on the wall is factored while calculating the soil air temperature. So U value is beyond conduction. U value has specific importance of consideration of convection and radiation also into picture, which is also going to affect the actual heat that is flowing through the wall into the building. So it is not just a material with exact thermal properties. It is being affected by radiation. It is being affected by surface conductance, which is also going through certain convection process, where it is offering certain heat transfer to the surrounding air. So that is why it is a combination of conduction, convection, and radiation together. So the term U factor should be used only where the heat flow is from air to air through envelope assembly, which is generally roof and walls, I would say. So for example, if I have a roof with certain some other material, then roof tiles are laid. So three different layers and surface air conductance and the surface air conductance inside, both of these are considered together to calculate the U value. So here air to ground heat flow is a different matter. Here we need to have a material assembly, and then we should have air layers, and that air layer to air layer conductance is what we consider as U factor. So this is what is about U value. Let us see a quick comparison between K value, R value, and U value. As we discussed in our last lecture, R value and conductance. So U value is nothing but conductance, we have understood. But conductance including surface air conductance or surface air resistance. So U value, if U value is low, the insulation is high, and we know that R value is nothing but 1 by U value. So if U value is low, R value will be high. And again, if the K value, to measure the material's ability to conduct heat, we discussed that K value is conductivity, which is the ability which is to allow heat flow to pass through. So if K value is high, which is conductivity is high, if the material is allowing too much of heat to pass through, definitely the heat flow through the U also will be high. If the K value is low, U value will be low. For insulators, conductivity will be low, U value will be low, the resistance will be high, or resistivity also will be higher. So K value is generally proportionate to U value. K value and U value are inversely proportionate to resistance. So, and if the resistance is low, which means insulation also will be low. If the resistance is high, insulation will be high. This is how we can understand these three major terminologies, and they are highly correlated among each other. So here I have a material, some material's wall of 1 meter thickness. So just simply, if I ask you a quick question, if these two materials are of same material, if these two walls are made of same material but of different thicknesses, this is of 1 meter thickness, this is of some other thickness. If it is less than 1 meter, let us say, the heat flow will be higher in this, lower in this. The heat, because the thickness is more, if the thickness is more, the resistance offered is more, the heat flow will be lower in this, heat flow will be higher in this. So let us see here, conductivity is 0.0036 for 1 meter, 1 meter thick wall. Same wall, conductance, when we take conductance, it is K by X, the conductance by thickness. We have discussed this in our last lecture again. Conductance by thickness, K value, conductivity by thickness gives conductance or U value. So U value or conductance is equal to conductivity by thickness. If you are confused, remember U value is proportionate to conductivity. If conductivity is high, conductance is also high. U value is inversely proportionate to thickness, because if we increase the thickness, the overall heat transfer will be lesser. So this is what we can remember. So that's how U value is proportionate to K by T. So this K by T is thickness here, that X is here. So you can see here 0.036 was the U value if it was 1 meter, but if the thickness is 0.25 meter, which is 1/4 of the wall, if you reduce the wall by 1/4, the U value, if it is 1, the U value will be K by 1, which is 0.036, but if it is 0.25, it is 0.114, which means the U value is increasing here from this one to this one. When you are decreasing the thickness, the U value is increasing, and the way to calculate it is this much. So once you have K value, and once you have thickness, U value is nothing but K by T, and unit should be kept in similar way. You should not mix up with mm with millimeters with meters. So if the wall thickness is 230 mm, you should not write 230 mm, you should write 0.23 so that your U value speaks out in a right way. So that's how 1 meter thick board of same material, if I reduce the thickness by 1/4, your U value will increase. But if you talk about K value, it is conductivity, which will be same in both because the material is same, but because there is change in thickness, the U value is varying. If U value, the overall U value of a thicker material, a thicker body will have a lesser U value. If it is thinner, it has higher U value. So if, in simple words, if you want to just remember this particular equation, a 9-inch brick wall when compared to maybe a 2 feet thick brick wall. So 2 feet thick brick wall is so thick that it offers too much of resistance, that the overall heat transfer for 1 square meter area for 1 degree change in temperature will be too less compared to just a 9-inch brick wall. Similarly, if I go for a 4-inch brick wall or very thin brick walls or very thin any other walls which conducts more heat, where the conductivity K value is higher and the thickness is lesser, the U value will be very, very, very high. So if the K value is high, U value will be high. If the thickness is high, U value will be low. So ultimately, you have to decide whichever wall you are designing, whichever roof you are designing, whether you want to conduct more heat or you want to restrict more heat, based on which you decide upon which material to choose, which offers more resistance, and what is the thickness that you should give so that it can take care of the thermal resistance that you need it for that particular space. So here there are three different materials. One is 150 mm RCC. This is RCC structure, reinforced concrete, cast in situ structure, where 150 mm thick RCC will have U value of 3.77. 200 mm thick solid concrete blocks, the concrete blocks which are compressed concrete blocks with 15 mm plaster will have 2.8 watt per meter square degree Kelvin. This is 230 mm brick wall which has 2.24. So out of these three, if my intention is to reduce the heat flow for 1 degree change in temperature from one side to other side, let us say this is brick wall, so this is outside, this is inside. So outside to inside, for 1 degree change in temperature for 1 square meter, let us say this area is 1 square meter area. So 1 square meter area for 1 degree change in temperature, about 2.24 watts of heat flow is happening. So 2.24 watts of heat flow means 2.24 joules is going from one side to other side every second. Joules per second is what we have seen in the earlier presentations. So 2.24 watts of heat flow is happening for each 1 square meter. If I have 10 square meters of wall, 2.24 watts into 10 square meters for 1 degree change in temperature of heat is flowing. If the temperature difference is not 1 degree, right, in general, indoors might be at 24 degree. Outdoor might be at 34 degree. If the temperature difference is 10, then the amount of heat that flows is also multiplied by 10 times. So out of these three, our intention is to reduce the U value as much as possible so that the overall heat flow into the building is lesser. So out of these three, currently a brick wall with 15 mm plaster is the best possible one compared to RCC and concrete blocks. So compared to the brick wall, we can even explore other materials as an assembly. Instead of going for 9-inch brick wall, you can even go for 4-inch brick wall with a small air gap, and again 4-inch brick wall, where 8-inch brick wall plus this air gap also offers certain resistance. Your overall U value might be much better than this 9-inch brick wall if we check it up. So here, this is AAC block which we have discussed, aerated concrete. So this is AAC, which is aerated autoclaved concrete or autoclaved aerated concrete. So AAC blocks are generally very porous in nature, very lightweight in nature, as we have discussed earlier. So the heat flow compared to the brick wall, the conductivity of this material is lower, which means compared to brick and stone or concrete or metal, this particular material conducts less heat. It offers much better resistance to the heat flow. So the overall heat gain that is happening for a 200 mm, which is 8 inches AAC block with 15 mm plaster, is 0.77. You can see in the for the 9-inch brick wall, we have seen it as 2.24 watts, which means about 1/3 of the heat is being the heat flow is being reduced by going for 200 mm AAC block wall with 15 mm plaster. If we increase the thickness from same material, if we increase the thickness, we know that U value should be little lesser because if we increase the thickness, the heat flow will be lesser, which means U value is nothing but our heat flow, which also should be lesser. And thus here you can see that the value is 0.54 compared to this 0.77. So you have to choose a material which has lower conductivity and give as higher thickness as possible. And when we are designing our building, we can even do a calculation of the costing for different materials and the impact of those different materials on the heat flow that is happening into the building, so that the building users are feeling comfortable indoors. So that's about conduction, where in conduction we are talking about U values specifically. U value talks about the overall transmittance. Now when it comes to convection, it is about the heat flow that is happening through the air movement from inside to outside. So thermal properties, thermal quantities with respect to heat flow is dependent upon the amount of air movement happening from indoor to outdoor and the temperature difference from outdoor to indoors. So it is a very dynamic calculation process where the temperatures keep changing and the air movement is also not just directly measurable, unless it is a mechanical system where you have specific fan which throws so much of air at a frequent quantity so and so temperature of air coming inside the building through a fan of so and so quantity, or going outside the building through fan of so and so quantity. So we can calculate the amount of heat that is being lost through that and gained through that. So we are not getting into that details in this lecture. If somebody is interested, you can check out our manual for tropical climates by Koenigsberger book. We have this particular topic being discussed with examples and calculations in that book. So we'll be moving to the radiation part of it. So let us say we have a building and there is solar radiation happening on the roof or on the wall. We know that the radiation, the heat that is coming through the radiation, if we go and stand in the sun, our body gets heated up because our body absorbs certain heat and body gets heated up, right? And the temperature also increases over the body surface. So similarly, on the building wall and roof, if we go to any hot place, hot dry climatic conditions or warm and humid climatic conditions, you will observe that the roof surface, the upper surface of the roof, gets super hot in the hot afternoons, the summer afternoons, because the radiation is adding heat to that material. The concrete is getting heated up. You can even check out your vehicles, cars, bikes, scooters, where you leave it in the sun for half an hour, 1 hour, and you go and touch it, it is super hot. That's because it is absorbing certain heat and increasing its temperature, and that amount of heat that is absorbed through radiation. So if the radiation is falling on certain surface, how much percentage or how much factor of it is being absorbed is what we call as absorbance. And at the same time, the heat that is absorbed already by any material is not just kept there within it, it also gets emitted again back to the environment. Let us say for this building, let us say this roof is heated up. Certain heat is emitted back into the outdoor environment, certain heat is emitted back into the indoor spaces. So this emittance, how much heat that it emits off out of the absorbed heat or something like that, is called as emittance. The short wave is absorbed and long wave radiations are emitted into the building. So this is about the glazing properties. Apart from roof and wall, where we are talking about absorptance and emittance, we are going to discuss about glass here specifically, where the incoming light, I mean, in fact, along with the light, there is solar heat also. So the heat is partially transmitted inside and partially reflected outside. So amount of light heat that is reflected outside, the remaining amount is being absorbed or transmitted inside. So we need to understand very clearly here, part is reflected, some little portion is absorbed, which is later re-radiated inside or outside. So this absorbed and re-radiation is also a property of the glass that is happening here. But the direct radiation, a part of the direct radiation is directly transmitted, which means if you go and stand near a window and the sunlight is coming, if you stand there, the light will fall on you, it will add heat on you. The heat is coming through the glass and coming inside. Let us say if you have a clear glass, a clean glass, which is not even shaded or tinted, full radiation might be coming inside. But if it is a shaded glass or tinted glass or a cooling glass, then the glass might allow only a part portion of it into the indoor spaces as a radiation that is coming in. So generally absorbance plus reflectance, so whatever is reflected and whatever is absorbed by that material may not be from the glass perspective, but in general, if it is a roof area, for example, amount of heat that is absorbed inside and amount of heat that is reflected should count to one. So whatever factor that absorption happens, the remaining factor is being reflected, or whatever factor is being reflected, the remaining is being absorbed. Then there is emittance after absorption. It emits the heat again back into the surrounding environment, and that's what we talk about emittance here. So for perfect reflective theoretical white surface, if there is a pure perfect white surface, the reflection that happens on the roof, we can say that there is no heat that is absorbed at all by that surface. And if it is a perfect reflector, then reflectance will be 1 and absorption will be 0. But for perfect absorber, which is let's say a black body which absorbs complete heat that is radiated onto that surface, that's where we see the reflectance as 0 and absorption as 1. However, this scenario is not practically possible to absorb all the heat or reflect all the heat with the common materials that we have in our in architecture in general, that what we use. So here, white painted surface generally absorbance is at 0.1 to 0.3. For bright metals, a metal surface which is very bright, the absorption is again the same, similar. So I can have a wood or metal, a white painted wood versus a metal. Both of them will have similar absorptions. Absorption. So the emittance will be different if based on the painted coating. How much heat that is being emitted after absorbing, how much heat that is being emitted will be different. So here the emittance coefficient is same as absorption only in case of perfect black body, but varies otherwise. The emittance is varying for perfect black body for in general for different scenarios, but absorptance will be same. It is based on the material property. Let us say there is a white surface, a material with white surface, a material which is not white coated. The same material, if it is the same material, based on the absorption reflection, the emittance values are also varying. Emittance values are also being same. Even absorptance also might vary. If there is a black car and white car kept side by side, and the reflectance of white car might be higher, though the material is same. It depends on the material, the surface properties, the color, and lot of other parameters. We don't generally can't say that the absorptions and emittance is same for a given material as such, very as a thumb rule kind of thing. Emittance again, it depends on the overall radiation that is being absorbed completely, and amount of heat that is being reflected completely. And within which, how much heat that is being emitted is what we are seeing as emittance. Then comes this sole gain factor, which is generally the rate of heat flow through a building element due to solar radiation expressed as a fraction of incident solar radiation. So the rate of heat flow through a building element, let us say you have wall, you have glass, the heat gain into the building should happen through solar radiation. Generally, if it is a thick wall, the radiation is not adding up too much of heat that is adding up to the heat. But if it is a glass, for example, so in glass, if it is a glass and the radiation is coming, so as we discussed, certain portion might be reflected and absorbed, but some portion will be allowed inside. So this heat that is absorbed and emitted and which is allowed inside, this whole radiation, the heat that is gained by the interior, due to this solar radiation, which is part of the solar radiation, is what we generally look at solar sole gain factor. Now there are different ways of seeing the sole gain factor. If we see only for the glazing, if we see only for the glass, where the how the glass is allowing the radiation inside is something that we talk in terms of shading coefficient. We will get into shading coefficient. Before that, let us see here three different aspects of glass. So here, heat gain, the solar radiation, the solar radiation is coming and part is allowed inside and part is reflected, as we know. And now we know that it is not just heat, it is also light that happens here. Then what happens here, apart from direct radiation that is adding heat, or the direct radiation that is adding heat to the indoors through this transmittance of the glass, there is certain heat that is being going as heat loss or coming as heat gain depending on the change in temperature. Like in cold places, it will be heat loss because outdoor temperatures will be very low and inner temperatures will be higher, so heat loss might happen. Or if the outdoor temperatures are hotter and indoor temperatures are conditioned space, then the heat will come inside. This heat flow due to the temperature difference, the heat flow that happens due to temperature difference is majorly being addressed by the U value, as we have discussed the conductance. So that when heat is flowing because of temperature difference, it means that it is passing through that body because there is temperature difference, which is nothing but conduction. But the radiation is something that is passing through that material through a radiation electromagnetic waves that is passing through that material. So the short waves are absorbed into the material, the long waves are passed through the material, the short waves are later being emitted into the surrounding spaces. So we have shading coefficient, which we will be discussing in the next slide, or there is another parameter called solar heat gain coefficient. So these are the two characteristics which defines the solar heat that is transmitted directly in the form of radiation. When we talk about with respect to the conduction, so the heat flow that is happening through glass through conduction, we are addressing it through U value of the glass assembly. Then there is light being transmitted. So how much amount of light is being transmitted inside? So if there is certain amount of light is coming from outside, and only how much amount of it is allowed inside? We have to be clear here, solar heat is different, solar light is different. This is visible spectrum, this is invisible spectrum. You can't see heat coming through it, but you can see light passing through it. So if the light is coming inside, we can see that, you know, the inner space will be lit and the light will be reflected inside, and certain amount of light will be felt by our vision. So this is called VLT, which is nothing but visible light transmittance. So visible light transmittance. So we have three different aspects of glass. When we select glass for a building, we have these three different aspects which are very, very, very important to know to make this glazing to perform as we need it in the house. Let us say a small room of 4 meter by 4 meter bedroom has a window, and if the window is provided with a very dark colored tinted glass, and we thought that, you know, this much window area is enough to get enough lighting, but instead of giving a transparent glass, if you are giving dark tinted glass, the room will not get enough lighting. So to understand how much light that comes from that window for that particular room, we need to be clear about these terminologies of visual light transmittance, especially for lighting, and we need to know about SHGC or shading coefficient, solar heat gain coefficient or shading coefficient for direct radiation, how much radiation is allowed by the glass inside. And also we need to know about the U value of the glass to understand how much heat is coming inside or going outside through conduction because of the difference in temperature. So these are the three aspects. One is SHGC or shading coefficient. Both are similar terms, only the way they are defined is different and the values might be slightly different, but both represent the similar phenomena of allowing the radiation through that particular building element. So visible light transmittance is VLT, which talks about light. SHGC or shading coefficient talks about the radiation part of it. U value talks about the conduction heat flow part of it through the same glass that we are talking about for any given building. So shading coefficient is a measure of radiative thermal performance of glass unit. So panel of window in a building, shading coefficient basically only upon the glass portion. So here we are talking only about the glass here. We are not considering the frame of the. So why we are talking about frame here is because the radiation that is being absorbed by the glass is being conducted to the frame and then dissipated into the rooms through convection. So this particular component of the heat flow happening into the building through the frame is not factored in shading coefficient. Shading coefficient is nothing but how much your glass is being shaded, how much percentage of the direct light is being cut off, or how much is being allowed. So let us say if shading coefficient is 0.25, which means the direct radiation is being cut off by 75%, only 25% is being allowed inside the building. So shading coefficient is generally given in terms of factor. Let us say if it is 0.25, which means from the glass only 25% of the radiation is directly allowed into the building, into the indoors. So when it comes to solar heat gain coefficient, as I told you, both are same similar terms, but the way they defined are different. In when the shading coefficient talks about the direct radiation that is being allowed, SHGC is a combination of both direct radiation and the other means of heat flow that is happening into the through that window. So here indicates the percentage of solar radiation incident upon glass glazing assembly. So we are talking about assembly here, but in shading coefficient we talked about only glass that ends up inside the building as a thermal energy. So whatever radiation that comes from the sun is coming through direct radiation or through conduction or through convection, whatever way that it is entering the building, ends up in the inside the building through that glass component, including the frame, is what we call as solar heat gain coefficient. So generally solar heat gain coefficient will be higher compared to shading coefficient of a given scenario. There is certain conversion factor of 0.87 if somebody wants to know about that conversion factor. So here in this example we have a blinds that are given, the curtain kind of thing that is given here. So heat is flowing through conduction and then dissipated through convection here, and there is a direct radiation that is coming inside. All this together is what we are taking in terms of solar heat gain coefficient, where there is direct and indirect heat gain happening, and both the direct and indirect heat gain are factored to calculate the solar heat gain coefficient of a given wall, of a given window assembly, glazing assembly. In other words, solar heat gain coefficient represents the ability of a glazing assembly, including both glass and frame, to resist the heat gain from solar radiation. So from solar radiation to resist the heat through glass and frame both together is what we are talking in terms of solar heat gain coefficient. A low SHGC indicates a good resistance, high SHGC indicates poor resistance. Simply, if the SHGC is low, as we discussed for solar shading coefficient, if it is 0.25, only 0.25 is allowed inside the direct radiation. When I say 0.25 SHGC, which means the total heat that comes through radiation and through the absorbed heat that is dissipated inside, altogether it will be 0.25, or it will be 25% of the total radiation that is coming from the sun. So that is a major difference, a major importance of solar heat gain coefficient. So again, there is no units for this. It is always represented as factor like 0.25, 0.5, which defines percentage of the overall radiation that is being incident on that glass surface. So here you can understand that the direct summer sun is being cut here. In summer, certain portion of the sun is being cut, and the projection is done in such a way that in summer the sun is not coming inside, which means only maybe certain diffused the reflected radiation might come inside. So very less portion, maybe 0.1, 0.05 is the solar shading coefficient. I would say here it's called shading coefficient because I'm not talking about any window or other parameters. So if you calculate SHGC here, SHGC will be somewhere near to 0.1 only. So in case if it is 0.1, so this is a simple example of to understand here SHGC is for winters it is high, for summers it is very very low because we are cutting off the sun directly. So it is not only that glass has to be having certain property of tinted glass or something like that. You can even have a shading device as we discussed in earlier lectures. Based on the sun path, we have to calculate the vertical shadow angle, horizontal shadow angle, and provide the shading device. So once you give shading device, it is going to cut down the radiation coming inside the building, and thus your shading coefficient of the glass also will be different. So here, this direct radiation is what we are worried about here with when we are talking about shading coefficient and solar heat gain coefficient. While the heat loss or heat gain happening through temperature difference is what we are addressing through U value. So U value, SHGC are major ones as we have discussed till now for the glass. Now we know that visual light transmittance here, if it is 0.75, which means 75% of the visual light is transmitted from outdoor to indoor. Then SHGC of 0.71, which means 71% of the solar heat gain is transmitted into the indoors through direct radiation and also through absorbed and dissipated heat gain that is also happening. Then there is U value of 0.29 watt per meter square degree Kelvin, let us say. So this means this U value, the thermal property, the conductance of this particular glass including the surface layers, is what is 0.29. So generally, if it is a single glass, the U value is very, very high, which is 5.88 watt per meter square degree Kelvin. Here, standard double glazing, the moment you put another glass, there is one glass, there is air gap and another glass. So because air also offers resistance, as we know, there are two glasses. So the overall heat flow will be much lesser, which offers much better resistance than a single glazing. That's why the U value will be little lesser in case of double glazing. So if you add a much insulated gas, argon gas, the inert gases are generally less prone to heat transfer. They are high resistance gases for heat transfer. If you add this argon gas, the U value will be further reduced. Then there is low E coating or double glazing with low E plus argon. You provide another coating where the SHGC or other aspects are reduced. So there also the U value is getting slightly affected. So because of these coatings and gases, the overall U value can be reduced. So by addressing U value, as we all know that we are addressing only the conduction part of the heat gain, not the radiation part of the heat gain. The U factor talks about conduction part of heat gain, while SHGC talks about the radiation part of heat gain, and VLT talks about visual light transmittance, so it talks about the visible light, so how much light is being transmitted from outdoor steam kind of. So this is 4 mm clear single glazed. So let us understand this word clear here. So here 4 mm gray colored glazing plus 12 mm spacer, then 4 mm again a clear glass. So this will reduce a certain amount of heat that is transferred through direct radiation. So the direct radiation is transmitted more in this case because it is clear glass. The moment you go for a cooling glass or tinted glass, here in this case this gray glass with double glazing, the overall heat gain through direct transmission is reduced by some more percentage. In this case the SHGC is 0.84, in this case it is 0.57. In the third case, it is a low E coated insulated glass. So it is an insulated glass already which has certain coating, and then which can reduce further heat gain. So the SHGC is 0.51, which means only 51% of the overall incident radiation is being allowed. So direct radiation can be cut down not by giving more layers, but by giving the coating or by giving a tintedness to the glass, or by providing shading over the windows, which can cut down the radiation falling on the window. So this is how SHGC will have an impact on amount of heat coming inside the building through the glass. So by giving louvers on the outside, you can still cut down the direct radiation that is coming inside. We have to be careful at what angle we are placing, how we are placing, without obstructing our objectives towards visible design. So you want to see outdoors, but you don't want sun to come inside. So you give horizontal louvers which are at spaced at a decent distance, so that you can see the outside world, but the sun is being cut, and that's how we can understand the particular place with the sun path, and then temperature differences and the material properties, and then decide whether how to design these louvers so that heat should not come inside, but visibility should be there. Or if you want airflow to happen, then you have openable windows. So there are different alternatives that we can explore by addressing these particular thermophysical properties of the materials. So we will see some other properties, some other characteristics of building elements in our next lecture, where we are going to discuss about more about the heat flow that is happening through these building components. So thank you for being with me. We will see you in the next lecture with more calculations and more discussions. Thank you so much.